afternoon to everybody. My name is Emilio Renaldi. I come from Politecnico di Torino, which is the, let's say, the university from which Dario come from, originally, let's say. And let's say I'm presenting a work on caching. It's essentially an analytical model, but of course I will, in the first part of the talk, I will introduce to you what is the Sean Noyce model, which is a traffic model. This work is a joint work with Gianluca Torrisi, who is a researcher at CNR, which is our national research council in Rome. As you know, you may know, caching systems are playing a fundamental role in internet and in, especially in the distribution of multimedia contents, video contents. Essentially, they are the core of content delivery networks. Content delivery networks, in an abstract way, can be seen as a network of caches. And they maybe will play even a more important role if in the future years we will assist to the shift from the today internet architecture to the new information-centric internet architecture. However, even if caches and network caches are playing a very important role in internet, and even if caching systems have been studied for 30, 40 years or something like that, they are classical systems, still there are, since they are very complex, there are many things which are not completely understood. And as you may know, in the last few years, caching became a hot topic. So many people are analyzing, studying, proposing, and so on, caching systems. Why they are complex, why, let's say, we don't know everything about caching systems, because typically the performance of caching systems depends in a very critical way from traffic assumptions. If you change, let's say, some parameters in the traffic, you see completely different things, and also they are intrinsically complex to analyze. When you, of course, this talk is about performance evaluation, so performance analysis. And so when you consider caching systems and you want to analyze it, there are essentially two ways, okay, two approaches. An analytical Monte Carlo approach, in which essentially you either build an analytical model or rely on an analytical model, or eventually you write a simulator. And in that case, you can study your the performance. You can analyze the performance of the of your caching system. But what you need is a traffic model. You need a synthetic traffic model to put as input of your simulator analytical model. The second approach, the dual approach, is a trace-driven approach. Of course, now there is a dispute between the internet measurement people that trust just traces and the model community that likes models. Which is best? Don't ask to me. But I think there is no answer, in the sense that both approaches have strong points, have also weakness. What is the strong point of trace-driven approaches? The strong point of trace-driven approach is that you play with real traffic. What is the limitation? The limitation is that you are constrained to traces, and typically no one has an infinite catalog of traces. And also traces reflect the today traffic. But if you want to predict things, if you want to build something that lasts 20 years, you need also to do if-else analysis. What happens if traffic shifts in this way, if the parameter change? No, the traces are not parametric. That is a huge limitation. You have just one trace or few traces, you can play with that. What is the limitation of analytical Monte Carlo approaches? The fact that you have to invent a traffic model. Whatever traffic model you invent, typically, somebody can say this is not real traffic. Okay. If we, and this talk is more related to the first approach, if you export the first approach, if you embrace the first approach, you need somehow to invent some traffic model that is realistic, knowing that this is a synthetic traffic model. It's you have to define a stochastic process that generates sample paths, and then you obtain, given a sample path, you can do the simulation. Okay? And of course, it's a model, so it's realistic, but it's still a model. It's not the real internet. And then when you have a traffic model, you can try to play to analyze the behavior and, let's say, to do performance evaluation of the caching system. This talk is essentially about the second point, okay? But before, let's say, consider the contribution of this talk, I have just to resume the properties and to introduce the property of the Shaun noise model, which is essentially the traffic model we use in our analytical model. This traffic model was presented there, and it was also obtained by Alain Simonian and other people. It was proposed essentially in parallel by us and other researchers. Essentially, the model is the same. Okay, first of all, let's do a step back. What is the more classical, let's say, the simplest traffic model, and also the widest used traffic model which is typically adopted, is the so-called IRM, Independent Request Model. Why it is so popular? Because it's very simple, and essentially it has just one parameter somehow. What is the IRM? The IRM, according to the IRM, essentially you play with a catalog of objects which is fixed, M objects, always the same. The number of objects is invariant with time, okay? And the process of request that arrives at the system of caches for every object is an homogeneous Poisson process, and of course different objects induce processes which are independent. Okay, this is the classical model, which is called IRM. What you have to specify is the traffic popularity profile. Give to me the rate of, for every content, the rate lambda of the associated Poisson process, and I have all the parameters. Typically, these rates, of course, you know that the contents are not homogeneous in internet, and typically what you play with a ZIF distribution that give to you essentially generate, permits to generate the different lambda. So yes, you do, when the different contents are ordered, the first is more popular, the most popular, and then the second most popular, and so on. If you play with the ZIF depends just on one parameter, alpha, so the higher M with the ZIF assumption has just one parameter you can play with. And this is the limit, but also the beauty of the model. Not very simple, just one parameter. What is the limitation? The limitation is that essentially you ignore in the IRM all the correlations between requests, temporal correlations between requests of the same content, essentially. There are generalizations. Typically, the generalization essentially requires you to replace Poisson process.
Just a question about you are talking about the correlation force between the request. Where does this correlation come from? Why are they correlated? What is the reason?
There are several reasons. One reason is, let's say, I will explain one of the reasons why you can see correlations. You can see also non stationary, let's say, the popularity process of each individual content, if you look to the internet, is not stationary. These models are typically stationary, you know, Poisson homogeneous. In practice, what you see is that every content has a popularity that lasts for a period, and then maybe vanish. There are different contexts also. There are contexts that are long-lasting. Think to the Disney movies, Disney cartoons, and so on. There are contents whose popularity is limited in period of time, the sport events. No? Who cares about the goals of soccer match of 20 years ago? Maybe somebody, yes, but the popularity is restricted to a few days. No? You watch the goals of the last soccer match, not the news, same thing, piece of news. Typically, you need, no, you are interested to update the piece of news, not... So it's complex, but that can be a cause, and typically what you observe from traces is that somehow there are correlations. Okay. How can you model? Okay, typically the classical model is to replace the Poisson process, let's say Poisson assumption, using a, let's say, more complex process like a renewal process or eventually Markov modeled process that allow you to introduce some form of correlations for the request of a given content. Typically, all the classical models are finite population models in which the content, the catalog content is static and the contents essentially live forever. What is the limitation of these models is the fact that essentially they, the extensions, the IAM ignore completely the correlations because you know that Poisson points are independent somehow. If you consider renewal or Markov modulus and so on, you can pretty well describe short-term correlations. But typically, you failed, it depends also on the process you use, but let's say typically the simplest process, like renewal process, are not able to capture long-term correlations among the request. The other fact is that, let's consider an experiment, okay? We took a trace, we had a few traces, we took a trace and the trace was essentially lasting 15 days, so our trace was, no, 1 month, sorry, Stefano, you know better than me, 1 month, more or less.
1 month, roughly.
Okay, the first, black curve, okay, of course, we use a cache, we fed a cache with our trace, and what we represent in this plot is essentially the hit probability, which is on the x-axis, is somehow anormal because we represent the cache size to achieve a given, essentially, hit probability. So if you fix 0,1, you see that the cache size is about around 2048 contents. Okay, the black is essentially the curve you obtain from the trace. Okay, then what you can do? You can take the trace, you can reshuffle the events, the requests. So you maintain exactly the number of requests for each content. Okay, the number of requests, so the distribution of popularity is unchanged, but what you break is correlation. Generating something which is similar to what you would generate with IRM using the same distribution of popularity. What you attain is the other extreme of curve, the red. Okay? Two observations, they are different. Okay? Essentially, the IRM is was let's say is pessimistic. Okay? It's induced estimate which are pessimistic. You have factor 3-4, more or less, it depends on also on where you put that. What is somehow surprising is that for even for small cache, you have a huge difference, and I will come back on that. Okay, and so even when the cache is smaller, so you expect that the dynamics in the cache are fast, and so long-term correlation should be not important because essentially you can invoke some time scale separation, even there are significant differences, even stronger here than here, let's say, okay? And what about the other curves? Okay, the other curves are obtained reshuffling in a partial way the trace. So let's take one, for example, this k equal to 4. What we did is cutting the trace in four pieces, in four sections. For every section, we reshuffled at random the request in that sections, but maintaining the request in the first section that were in the first section, in the first section, and so on. And what you see is that when you increase k, so you reduce the window of the reshuffling window, slowly, but not so slowly, you approach the black. And essentially, when you have 3 hour shuffling, which means that you break all the correlations below 3 hours, okay, and you maintain the long term means on time scale which are above 3 hours, okay, then you obtain something which is very close to the realistic, the real trace curve. So this means that essentially short term, at least very short term correlation, are not so important to be captured, while medium and long term correlations are pretty important. Okay? The policy, I forgot to say, is an LRU. So this is just one case implementing a policy which is the standard policy, LRU policy. Why that? Okay? What is the explanation of that? The explanation of that is that if you consider essentially the distribution of popularity over different time scales, the distribution of popularity over different time scales is fairly different. Okay? So if you consider long-term distribution of popularity, you have this distribution. If you consider the distribution of popularity over slice, which becomes shorter and shorter, the distribution changes. This means that somehow, if you are able to find the blue curve, okay, if you are able to evaluate the instantaneous popularity distribution, you can still play with IRM. I'm not saying that IRM is completely invalid. I'm saying that to play with IRM, you need the right distribution. Unfortunately, the instantaneous distribution is very difficult to be obtained. Look at the confidence interval there. Okay. While the long term distribution is easy because I have a long trace, I count the request, I have the numbers. If I make the trace shorter and shorter, the distribution of popularity of an individual content over this period that becomes shorter becomes very noisy. Okay. And so obtaining that is somehow difficult. The other limit of the IRM and similar models is that they are not phenomenological. Okay, this instantaneous popularity distribution is something that is somehow not easy to be measured, and let's say it's not related to what you easily see from traces. Okay. So the lesson we learned, essentially, I already said everything. Is that even when the cache are small, typically IRM, naively used, let's say, using a long-term distribution can be problematic. You can use, in principle, in a good way IRM. You need somehow the instantaneous popularity distribution, but that is difficult to be obtained. And somehow the parameter of these distributions are not, let's say, related to physical parameters. What we would like to build is something that is more phenomenological, okay, and relates the parameters of the traffic model to what you see from the trace. And what do you see from the trace? Typically, you see that contents are not lasting forever. Contents are first generated. Goals of last soccer match. Okay, they were generated when the last soccer match was played, before this video was not available. Okay, then they have a popularity that evolve over time, and then typically in most of the contents, not all, but most of the contents die somehow, in the sense that they are not more anymore interesting and they are not anymore accepted. So the SNM, Show Noise Model, is trying to capture this. And what is the idea? The idea is that still we maintain essentially the basic idea of the IRM to see the global process of request as the superposition of independent process, which are the processes related to different contents. But for every content, okay, we associate to every content three parameters. This is much more critical, and we will see why. What is the first? Tau is the time at which this content was introduced. As I said, the contents somehow are not living forever. Typically are generated at a given time. And so that is the birth date, essentially the birth time of the content. What is VM is the volume, the number of, on average, the average number of requests that this content attract over a long-term period. Okay, if I have a trace from here to eternity, I count for every content how many requests they received, and I have this V. And what is lambda? Why lambda is critical? Because lambda is a function, it's not a scalar content, scalar parameter. Lambda is a profile, a shape of popularity. Okay, so this model is much complex, much more complex, because for every, in principle, for every content, you have to define three parameters, and one of the parameters is an infinite dimensional parameter. No, it's a function, it's not a scalar parameter. Okay, we can simplify the model making assumptions. Anyway, the three parameters are the time to generate the content, the volume, and the popularity profile. Given these three parameters, okay, we assume that requests are generated, so arrive at the system, at the caching system, as a non-homogeneous Poisson process with this intensity, so Vm times lambda m, let's say translated in Tm, okay? So this Lm of lambda m is typically a right function, it's a causal function, so it starts with tau m is 0 before tau m. Okay, the integral of this is 1, so this represents essentially the number, the average number of requests. Okay, as I said, you can say, okay, very complex, you have to specify one function per content, you have to specify a volume per content, you have to specify an instant, a birth instant for content. Okay, we can make some assumption. For example, we can make the assumption that contents are divided in classes, okay, equivalence class, and contents in the same class have the same profile. Okay, this simplifies significantly. Then you can assume that contents in the same class arrived, the birth times of contents in the same class is Poisson. Okay, and so essentially you can specify tau m giving just one parameter, the rate at which they arrive. And then you can say that contents in the same class have a volume that can be deterministic or can be a random value, but according to a given distribution. So if you consider the simplest case, the simplest case in which you have just one class of content, you have to specify the rate of, let's say, the Poisson process that generates tau m, you have to specify the distribution of volumes, which is essentially the popularity, the long-term popularity distribution of contents. Further, you have to specify the profile, okay? For all the contents, the same profile, anyway. Given that, essentially what you do, this is the graphical representation. Given that, essentially you have the content popularity of one content, okay, this is general, we assume this to be different, which is V1 lambda 1, this is the rate of the Poisson process according to which request arrive, and then you have the request, you generate the request. Similarly, for the same second content, and so on. What is important to stress is that essentially we have to define this parameter, okay, which is it's just a mathematical definition. The essentially the intuition behind the definition of this parameter is that this represents the time span, the life, the effective life of a content. Okay, how long does it take before it dies? Okay, so assume this as a kind of life. Okay, the definition is not so intuitive, but believe to me, that is the meaning of this parameter. And now we can try to validate. Okay, so we again we have the real trace results. Again, we have the IRM results, same experiment as before, same cache, the RU in which we plot the hit probability, the cache size versus the hit probability. And what we did is essentially from the trace extracting parameters, okay, for to set essentially the parameters of the show noise. Essentially, we played with five classes. Okay, we grouped contents in five classes according to their lifespan. Okay, contents that live for a very short period of time and were essentially grouped in one class. Contents that live for a longer period of time, defining thresholds essentially, were grouped in the second class and so on. Then we measured essentially in a, somehow in a rough way, these parameters for every class, okay, the average of these parameters for every class, and then we feed the data, okay? And what is important just to observe is that another parameter important is the shape. Do you remember the shape of the, okay, what is a result which is relevant and interesting, but it was somehow unexpected, is that the shape of the profile is not so important for the performance. Okay, these two models were using different shapes, exponential in one case, uniform, so just a rectangular shape in the other case. We also tried with power law and so on, other shapes, and essentially the results you get more or less are the same, as long as you maintain for the same class the same LM. Okay, so this is the parameter which is very important. Then the shape of the detailed shape of the profile is not so important, seems not so important for the performance. But this is a good point, okay, it's just, let's say, something that we empirically found. But it's a good point because the shape is the parameter which is more complex to evaluate because it's an infinite dimensional parameter. So the fact that the model, the performance are almost invariant with respect to that parameter which is difficult to be obtained from the trace is a good point of the model.
Maybe, excuse me, how sensitive is it to the number of classes? So less classes, more
to
classes?
The number of classes is sensitive in the sense that we didn't do a we had some preliminary results, then in the paper there is just an experiment with five classes. Of course, from five to infinite, you have just this margin. So, but from five to four, four to three, three to one, up to one, you can have a huge difference, okay? Because of what you have to capture is that in practice and what you see from the trace, there are contents which are very short-lived and contents which are long-lived, okay? Of course, the contents which are long-lived are difficult to be, the parameters, the profile of contents which are long-lived are also difficult to be evaluated from the trace we have because we have just one month trace. So everything which is longer than one month for us is infinite somehow. But instead, we have seen a few contents which are living 2, 3, 4, 5 days. 1 week or less, and those are the contests that are essentially have a huge impact on the caching performance. Okay. So modeling properly those content is important.
So I suppose that the composition in LM is not uniform, so there are perhaps...
No, it's not uniform, it's somehow geometric, let's say. With the fifth class, which is essentially IRM, contests that last forever. Okay.